Yes, chapter 14. Oh, that was a different crowd. Okay. Last week we started on chapter 14 when we started talking about where do you fit in God's family. And you remember we kind of summarized a little bit of the first three or four verses of chapter 12. And then we talked about Chip's friend. And we also talked a little bit about how in some cases, not all, but in some cases, how spiritual relationships can actually be stronger than biological relationships. I think some of us have actually experienced that firsthand. We looked at a couple of biblical passages to help support that. And then we also talked about belonging is a God-given need. We were all wired to need somebody. There has not been one person that has been created that did not have a need for somebody else. Amen? We talked about how that supernatural community, how it's so important, and everyone has a role to fulfill. All the parts of the body and all the members of that body has a role to fulfill. Even if that body or that member or that part is an obscure part, it still has a role to play. Amen? Amen. And then we ended on watching out for the comparison game. I want to talk a little bit about that starting out tonight. And Brother Ingram, Pastor Ingram, has a quote there under that subtitle, and I went ahead and typed it out for us on our handout. He says, our weakness demand that we become dependent on other people by being vulnerable and open in our relationships with one another. So he's saying that first statement, that because all of us have weaknesses, and I don't mean to speak for you, but I think I know you fairly well. All of us have weaknesses. And because of those weaknesses, that demands for us to become dependent, or a word that I prefer, become interdependent with the rest of the members of the body of Christ, right? And then he says, however, when we are unclear or have a distorted view of ourselves, we tend to compare our differences rather than appreciate them. And I have on there, competition within the body of Christ is dangerous. Why is that? Why is competition within the body of Christ, how can it be dangerous? You are exactly, absolutely right. You can mess up and divide a church when you are trying to compare or compete with somebody else. And usually when that person who is trying to compete with somebody else, they usually have some insecurities. They have some inner issues themselves that they haven't quite worked out yet. And it would drive a division within the body. Amen. And so we have to be careful about that kind of stuff. It could really mess up the role and the purpose and the function and the operation of the church when you have folks competing with one another. Amen. We'll look at one verse real quick, and I'm there, so I'll go ahead and read it in 3 John 1 and 9, back in the back of your Bible there. He says, this is John. He said, I wrote something to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to be first among them, does not accept what we say. And what John talks about in that verse is this fella is a preeminent person. He wants to kind of stand out in the crowd. He wants to be up front. And guess what? He wants it all to be about him. If it didn't come from him, it don't go. And he is causing some tension and some strife in that local assembly. And John has to call it out. He said, man, we could really be somewhere, but if it wasn't for this fella putting the brakes on everything, we would be a lot far ahead than where we are now. And there are people, believe it or not, in the body of Christ, if they didn't come up with the idea, if they're not recognized because of something they did, if the pastor don't call their name, if they are not acknowledged in Sunday school class, if they're not given a that a boy or that a girl, they will cause some issues in the church. Amen, lights. And there can be a disturbance and a danger in the body of Christ. And I love the way he uses that metaphor, right, about the body. Paul says this organization or this organism is a body. You shouldn't have on your person two arms competing with one another. If one arm is weaker than the other, then it's your responsibility to build that other arm up so they are as strong as the other, right? And so there shouldn't be competition or comparing, but there should be some interdependence to build or help the other part or member out. You with me? So I have on here, a competitive person or competitive people seek to glorify who? Always themselves. It's always about them. They're the main attraction. And then the next one, competitive people place trust in human ability instead of placing their trust in whom? God. And the opposite of competition is what? Cooperation and unity. And that's what we need to be about. We need to be about cooperation and unity. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Ephesians chapter 4. And I know Pastor Ingram talks about Ephesians 4 a little bit, but I want to look at a few things in that particular passage. Ephesians chapter 4, and we'll look at verses 15 and 16. One of the interesting things about not only Ephesians, but even in some of Paul's other letters, is that there is this dynamic, if you will, this dynamic that has to do with individual identity and corporate identity. I don't know if you've ever noticed that, but in a lot of cases in the epistles, the scene will change. He'll talk about the individual identity, and he starts off by saying everything that God has done for you. And as a result of what God has done for you, you ought to be like this. And then he transitions from the individual identity to the corporate identity. It's like he's saying, if you don't get this right, you're not going to fit right over here. Because in order to fit right over here, you got to be right over here. Now, it has nothing to do with being perfect. It has nothing to do about being complete or that you arrive. But there's something that has to go on over here. And what is that something? Come on, Bible. Individual identity. What should happen for a person to become a member of the body of Christ? You got to be saved. You have to accept Jesus as your Lord and your personal Savior. If you have not done that, you will not fit in the body. That makes sense? But once you have done that, then God places you in the body. Now, here's the thing. God will place you as a hand. place you as your foot. He'll place you as an arm. God knows where to place you. And I believe this too. God has kind of wired us in a way that whatever that you enjoy or find a lot of satisfaction or fulfillment in, more than likely that is your gift. And that's where you belong. So we have to be careful that if God has placed us as a hand on the body, that we're not also tiring ourselves out trying to be feet as well. It doesn't quite work out that way. Amen? Let's look at 4 and 15, 16 just a little bit. And so in, actually I want to look at verse 11 first of chapter 4 of Ephesians. And he says there in chapter 4, verse 11, Paul says, and he gave, and who's the he? Okay. Some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, some as pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of service to the building up of the body of Christ. What is Paul saying God did in verse 11 and 12? Who can summarize that? Okay, everybody has a talent, all right? Okay, absolutely. There is a diversity of gifts. I think that's probably the first thing Paul would like for us to share tonight, that there's a diversity of gifts. Not everybody has the same gift on the body. That makes sense? If everybody had the same gift, what would happen? Be chaos, competition. Yeah, we wouldn't get nowhere. But more than all of that, there would be needs unmet, right? Because if all of us had the same gift, and when that gift needed to be manifested, there's nobody else in the room that can help meet that need, because we're all the same thing, okay? So here's another way to kind of look at that real quick in verse 11. We talk about the diversity of gifts, but what Paul is saying is that God gave people gifts, okay? He's talking about, I'm going to put these people as gifts in place to help bring about structure, unity, so on and so forth. Look at that a little bit. Prophets, evangelists, teachers, pastors. For what? For the equipping of the saints, for the work of service. So what is the goal? He mentions it there at the end of verse 12. What's the goal? And another word for edify is to build up the body of Christ, right? Then in so how are Christians to grow? Anybody? How are Christians to grow? We grow in knowledge. You kept reading verse 13, didn't you? Verse 13 says, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. Right? And then he goes on, and you're going to see, this is probably going to kind of mess you up in a second. You're going to see how he contrasts in just a second. To a mature man. Now, he's not talking about male or female. He's really talking about humanity or a person. Mature man to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. So we grow by knowing more about Christ, and we grow the more we are unified in Christ, right? And the goal is to become mature. You feeling me? The goal is to not stay like an infant, but to become mature. And he says, to the measure of stature, which belongs to the fullness of Christ. Now watch how he contrasts. Verse 14. As a result, we are no longer to be what? Children. Tossed here and there by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, by craftiness and deceitful scheming. You know, you can almost, you take a little kid and you can tell them just about anything and they'll believe. You're exactly right. You can mold and shape a child, 6, 7, 8-year-old child, by just telling them, you done told them about Santa Claus and they believed it, they were 18 years old. You tell them about Tooth Fairy. My mom told me about Tooth Fairy and put money on there and borrowed it from me the next day. And I've quickly been, ain't no Tooth Fairy around here. But Paul says you'll fall and believe for that stuff if you're not rooted in the Word of God. And number two, if you're not united to the body of Christ. So what's the opposite of being united? Divided, right? So how will your hand, how will it thrive if it was severed from your arm? It ain't gonna make it. Now it may be sustained for a little while, right? If you can preserve it and do some things with it, hurry up and get to the hospital and this, that, and the other. And then they reattach it. But the longer it stays off or apart from your body, it's going to die, right? It's going to fade. It's going to wither away, right? So you have to make sure that you are a part and functioning to the body of Christ. If not, there can be some turmoil, some disappointment. And then he says, I have on here a question. What should be avoided? That's in verse 14. What should be avoided? Childishness, that should be avoided. And what else? Yeah. If you're mature enough, you won't fall for that stuff. If you're a mature saint, you don't think twice about those holy cloths that they sell on TV for $19.99. If you're a mature saint, you don't have to buy into this paying $25 for a little bottle of holy water that came from a spring in Jerusalem. You're mature. You don't have to do all that kind of stuff. I used to see stuff on television. I'm like, nobody's falling for that. And you find out these cats are making millions of dollars. I mean, private jets, and they doing all kind of stuff because people are just immature. They don't know. And I can point them out. Here's what happens. They're infants, but they think they know everything. Does that sound familiar? You got something in your family, don't you? They're babes, but you can't tell them nothing. They got it all figured out. And you've heard this phrase before, I don't need to go to church to get what I need, right? And them are the, I mean, I'm trying to watch my language, but you know what I'm trying to say. Them kind of people just irk me, right? Know everything, but don't know anything. But you can't tell them anything. They're babes, but they know everything, right? And they're disjointed. They're not a part of the body of Christ, and they're just dysfunctional. You feel me? And then I have on here verse 15. But speaking the what in love? What's more important, truth or love? It's a trick question. where you get that from? I got that on there? That's right. Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's actually in the Bible. Speaking the truth in love. And so there's actually a balance, right? And so to kind of help that out a little bit, you don't want to love somebody so much that you won't tell them the truth. You don't want to do that. You're exactly right. And then you don't want to accentuate the truth so much where it's not done in love. Because when you do that, then the truth you have is not received. You're exactly right. And so it must be, truth must be balanced by love. Okay? When you tell it should be the motivator should be love. I'm saying this because I love you, right? Then in the B portion of 15, it says we are to grow up in all aspects into Him, who is the head, even Christ. What is Paul saying there in that B portion? Grow up in all, my translation said, all aspects into Him. What is Paul saying there, you think? Mm-hmm. 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 Yeah, yeah. And so when he says all aspects, we have the premier example of what it means to be mature, Jesus Christ. And so when he says all aspects, just go, I mean, that three-year ministry, just go back and just look at all of those occasions, all those encounters Jesus had with people, all of those sayings, all that. I mean, just look at, you know, the woman who was caught in adultery. And that whole story trips me out because I'm like, well, if she was caught, then that implies one of y'all was probably with her. But that's a whole different subject in itself. But they wanted to condemn her. And Jesus, what did he do? Just kneeled down. And he said what? Those famous words, what did he say? Yeah, and daughter, sin no more, right? And he always had those encounters. And so when we kind of get beside ourselves, what Paul is saying, go back and look at those different facets and aspects of Jesus, how he handled people, how he handled adversity, how he handled temptation, how he handled Satan. All those things, we need to go to the premier example of Jesus Christ, all right? And then verse 16, from whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by that which every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. And so if you take that first part of 16, you'll understand how the body works in the latter part of verse 16. Okay? So the first part, he says, from whom the whole body being fitted. Now, who does the fitting? Christ does. Christ strategically, it's an intelligent design. You take your body, for instance, and how everything is where it needs to be to function. You're able to do things in everyday life that you would not have been able to do if Christ didn't do what he did for your body, right? Just think about your ligaments. And, I mean, just say you had, you know, your head itch, and you didn't have good elbows to scratch your scalp. Or something happened on below your knees, and your back wasn't able to bend for you to get down there to do what you had to do. All those those things function the way they're supposed to. And God fitted those parts together to function properly, to accomplish a goal, to accomplish an objective, not just to be together, just to be together. He fitted it because there was a goal in mind. And he says there at the latter part, there it is, latter part of verse 16, because if it works properly in each individual part, this will cause the growth of the body for the building up of itself. So we can build this body up if each individual part works like it should. Amen? Amen. Any questions are about Ephesians 4, those verses we lifted up? And that last one I have there, we must be united. No, scratch that. We must be close to one another in order to grow. We must be close to one another. You can't be united if you're far apart. You must be close to one another in order to grow. Then Dr. Ingram talks about the power of clarifying your strengths and your weaknesses. And I like the way he puts this. He said something about strengths is about how am I using them to help others. God didn't give me this talent, this ability, this gift for me to sit on it. He gave it to me to help somebody else. All right? And then weaknesses. How am I inviting other believers into my life as I myself am vulnerable? The easiest thing for us to do is to talk about our strengths. The toughest thing to do is to admit our weaknesses. Isn't that right? Why is that? Why is that? Ma'am? You're absolutely right. Pride has a whole lot to do with it. What else? Ding, ding, ding. We don't trust one another. So if I'm vulnerable in front of you, my fear is you might take advantage of me. I can't have you one up me, right? And so you're absolutely right. So what I wanted to do, and I know as a homework assignment, we'll actually do what Chip's saying. We'll list some of our strengths and weaknesses and so on and so forth, but kind of, I think, a good segue to kind of motivate you to do that is to kind of look at the disciples, right? Because I believe all of the disciples had weaknesses. All of them had weaknesses. There was nobody was perfect. So out of that group of 13, who was perfect? Only one was perfect was Jesus Christ. That was it. All of them had, and I want to look at a couple of them real quick. And I didn't get a chance to really finish this. I just picked out a few brothers to kind of pick on. But the first guy who was the easiest to pick on when I was putting this together was Simon Peter. And I want to look at just a couple of verses real quick so we can, get a glimpse of who he was. Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 14, we'll look at verse 28. Matthew 14, verse 28. Someone read 28, 29, and 30. On one hand, you can see Peter's strength as being a person who had courage. Would you say that? the only one who dared to take a risk and walk on top of the water and try to get to where Jesus was old Peter. That takes a lot. Who in here would have got out of the boat and walked on water? Try to do that. Who would have did that? If you raise your hand, I want to see it tonight. This brother was a very courageous brother. But he also had some flaws. Let's look at 17 and 4. I think that's where I want to go. 17 and 4. So this is the transfiguration. And Jesus, remember, he took Peter, John, and James with him. And they get to this mountaintop. And then who is there on the scene there in verse 3? Jesus and who? And I'm telling you, if I would have saw that, I would have just been so overwhelmed. But I would have been just blown away to see the Lord in the middle of Moses and Elijah, right? But what does Peter do there in verse 4? Peter, what did he do? He missed the whole significance of it. He said, well, since y'all here, let's make some tabernacles. Let you fellas get comfortable. We pitch some tents and we can have something to eat later on. It just went over his head. But he was just a person who just said what came to his mind. And that was Peter. Look at one more, Matthew 26, 33. And Jesus said in 34, truly I say to you that this very night, not tomorrow or next week or next year, but this night, before the cock crows, you shall deny me, not one time, not two times, three times, right? Peter was a very, what I call, impetuous or impulsive person. When I say impetuous or impulsive, he didn't think things all the way through. Sounded good, felt good, seemed like the right thing to do right now. I'm just going to do it or I'm going to say it. The significance of and the weight of what Jesus was saying, Peter missed. No, Lord, I'll ride or die with you. And Jesus, knowing his heart, man, before the cock even crows, you're going to deny me three times. And you fast forward, when they identified this brother, he didn't just curse, he went to cussing, didn't he? Right? He didn't. No, I don't know the man. Jesus knows him. That was his weakness. He had strengths, he had weaknesses. I want to look at James real quick. Go to Luke chapter 9, verse 54. Luke 9, 54. Now, y'all know James and John, they were brothers, right? Okay. Luke 9 and 54. Someone read 54 and 55 and 56. Yeah, so it's safe to say that these brothers were a little quick-tempered. Perhaps had some issues with forgiveness. they had some issues with people not agreeing with them. And so, you know, my man said, well, it's all right with you. I'm just going to call fire down and just burn them up. Now, here's the part that trips me out. Where in the world did he get the idea that he had power to call down fire? He just out of nowhere, if you tell me, I'm going to call fire down, Lord. Just out of nowhere, right? So this brother, too, had some weaknesses. But if you think about this as well, during Jesus' earthly ministry, who were the closest to him? Peter, James, and John. And so that was kind of his strength. He saw Jesus in that garden. Now, you know, he fell asleep, but he saw him for a little while. He was there, you know, when Jesus was still away for a while. He was there with Jesus all the time. So that closeness, that was a strength that he had. He was close to Jesus. And then you look at John's strength, right? Who was at the cross when Jesus was being crucified? Old John. And what did Jesus say to John while he was hanging on the cross? Mm-hmm. And what else? Mother, behold thy son. Amen. So you think about that, just, you know, and John refers to himself as what? The beloved. And he would say this, whom the Lord loved. He would throw that in there. You know, these other fellas, but, you know, who Jesus loved. He would put that in there. Yeah, I'm on him, right? But this the same beloved disciple who went to Jesus, remember that? And had audacity to take his mama with him. Sit on the left, and Jesus said, you have no idea what you're talking about. You have no idea what you are asking for. And had to get on all of them about that, right? So he had weaknesses, and I have there, you know, to even say that was a little selfish. The forget about all these other boys. Let me and my brother sit on your right or your left. That's being selfish. Matthew, and we'll have to go into that one, but, you know, some of his stuff, he understood people, accurate record keeper, weakness, a little short-sighted. Thomas, obviously his weaknesses, that he was a doubter, and I even added on that he was a pessimist. Some come up, you're just like, that's it for that then. But he was also a realist, even though it wasn't necessarily in the positive realm, but Thomas was kind of real. So all of these brothers had weaknesses. All of them had strengths. No. I couldn't find one. Judas did not have any strengths. None. And had a major weakness. You could say his weakness was probably money. And you could probably list, sir, love of money. Yeah. And you could probably list some other things as well. In reading, one of the things that one commentator said was, notice how the disciples are always listed. About three or four, you can kind of look at this on your own, three or four places where all of the disciples are listed together. Usually, the first three are always Peter, James, John. Guess who the last fella listed? Judas. And he was saying that back in antiquity, you were listed based on the closeness you were to the leader. And so here was a fella, Judas, who was always at the end, never made it away to get closer. 3 years 3 years with Jesus and never made an attempt to try to understand who he really was. Saw everything that the other disciples saw. Man, he saw Jesus feed 5,000, not to mention women and children. He saw Jesus walk on the water. He saw Jesus heal the blind and cure the sick and deliver people from diseases and raise Lazarus and all of that. But he never got close to him. And yet, by the sovereign power of God, Jesus still chose him. Now, that's a whole different theological session that I don't have time to talk about tonight. But here's what I do want us to kind of look at. With these other disciples, even though they had weaknesses, Jesus still chose them. And in spite of their weaknesses, Jesus knew, this little church on the move, Jesus knew how each one of them would fit. And sometimes Jesus will place us on a part of the body because he know we will be a good balance for the other part of the body. Even though they had shortcomings, even though they had flaws, even though they had faults, he still adopted them to be a part of the body. Isn't that good news? That Jesus will take misfits, and help us fit into the body of Christ. He does that. And so even though we have weaknesses, he wants us to be vulnerable and take the strengths of somebody else to help us out. That's where that interdependency comes from. And when we do that as a body, we become stronger. But if we fail to do that, we have a tendency of having one body part. You ever seen someone who complains about their right hip? Right? They got a bad right hip. And then a month later, they're complaining about their left knee. Or they got a bad left elbow. And all of a sudden, they're complaining about their right shoulder. What's happening? So that body part that's hurt or not functioning properly, the rest of the body has to overcompensate in order to keep the body moving, to keep the body functioning. If they don't do that, they won't get anywhere. Now, the danger of that, though, is the body part that's overcompensating tires out. And we don't need saints being wore out, right? We don't need saints rusting out. We need to help one another so that we are a functioning body. Amen? Amen. You have any questions? I'm through. It's Holy Week. We need to get ready for Sunday.